Well, this is actually my belief. If you look at social scientists, the kind of the focus, the fundamental question of their lives, of their life work, usually comes out of their social context. And of course, this is so in the social sciences, but we know that even in the natural sciences, when the problems appears to be completely unrelated to particular biography, very much the way the life work even of natural scientists very much related to their personal biographies. So in my case, obviously, being born in Spain, a very traditional society, closed during the Franco regime, and then the question of modernization, how society is modernized, was of course obsessive for me. So I became very much interested in the question of modernization. Then I studied theology. So the question was secularization, secular societies. I studied theology in the 60s at the University of Innsbruck, at a time when even the theologians were proclaiming the death of God, the secular city, so it was taken for granted by the theologians themselves. And then I came to study German sociology at the New School for Social Research in New York. And there I confronted American society. And as a European, I was struck, like every European visitor, how religious the American people are. And this was something that could not be explained with the theory of secularization. The most modern of societies, the United States, was also the most religious of modern societies. And of course, the way of explaining it was America is the exception to the rule. The Americans are crazy. Nobody can understand them. They are simply an anomaly. But then, as the whole world becomes more modern, it also becomes more religious. So the secularization theory that had been the basic paradigm shared by all the social sciences, by all the schools of sociology, have to be put into question. And to a certain extent, my life thereafter has been trying to understand the emergence, because it's not re-emergence, it's not the emergence of new forms of religion all over the world, and how different this is from the experience of secular Europe. So to a certain extent, I've been all my life a European in America, and when I go to Europe, I go as an American trying to explain to the Europeans how the whole world is not like Europe on these issues. And more I realize that it's neither Europe is the model nor America, but the whole world is very, very complex. So I increasingly do work comparing Catholicism and Islam and the very religious system in India, the tremendous revival of all forms of religion and Chinese cultural traditions in China right now. So in any case, if you look at the BRICS, the so-called emerging economies, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa, all of them are characterized by tremendously alive kind of resurgence of religious pluralism in all forms. So in this respect, they present a challenge for us Europeans. And to a certain extent, this has been the biographical challenge of my life. Well, it depends what you mean by religious. Obviously, I'm religious in my own way. I'm not an Orthodox Catholic. I was obviously, I grew up as a Catholic. In Spain, everybody was a Catholic. Like Holland 50 years ago. It was a very religious society 50 years ago, before the radical secularization. But then I studied theology, what means it gives you a reflexivity. So I'm not a traditional religious person, but religious questions, both cognitive and personal questions, are important for me. Yes, but in the sense of being, while we accept multilingualism, right, that we can be competent in many different languages and feel at home in many different languages, somehow because of our monotheistic tradition, one can think if one is Catholic, cannot be Protestant, and you cannot be Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox, Jew, Muslim, and to a certain extent, I am a kind of a little of everything. I'm a bit Catholic, I'm a bit Protestant, a bit Orthodox. My wife is Ukrainian, and I know the Orthodox traditions very well. A bit Hindu, a bit Muslim, a bit Confucian. So in this respect, yes, my encounter with the world religions has forced me to put into question my own Christian beliefs. Well, the process is before we thought that history, the theories of modernization had assumed that Europe the United States was, if you wish, the end of history or the telos of history, and that the rest of the world will basically join European developments. What globalization does is to decenter the Eurocentric histories and creating an open space where all cultures, all religions, all histories have to find a common life and have to live together. So there is no end point of history, there is only a global space. So it is from modernization, secularization, where still within the Western-centric Christian idea of history, globalization decenters Europe, decenters the European and the Christian story, and opens up to a multiplicity of collective stories of global humanity. So this is what globalization adds, not so much that it's an alternative, but it is opening up the story of modernization into a more global, pluralistic. Well, globalization is a complex story. If we look at technological, the media revolution, of course, this is what really has made us into a single village, right? The fact that we can basically connect with anybody in the world. As you know, I am beginning this project on the Jesuits and globalization because they were truly the first connectors. If globalization has two dimensions, one, the one of connectivity, all societies, all peoples, all cultures of the world get interconnected and somehow, so the close connections, global interconnectivity, the other is of course global consciousness. And you would say the Jesuits are the first. Their lemma was, the world is our Paris. And so it's our home. And they view themselves as humans sharing a global humanity around the world. So this is an aspect of globalization. But of course, what makes it possible, before they connected, but only the elites, and their life did not affect many people. They affected the preparation of the process now, which has democratized the contacts. Now it's not only elites that migrate, of course, already in 16th century you have already blacks being taken over as slaves from Africa to America. So global migrations have always been part of globalization. But of course today connectivity is linked to these global migrations, global media, global capital, global flows. But this doesn't mean that everybody is becoming the same. Even the European Union, as we know, we see how the different cultures of Europe. Europe that has basically the same Christian culture, the same history, and yet the resistance of national particular cultures within Europe. At the global level, of course, precisely the emergence of the BRICS indicates democracy in India. Of course, it's taken from the West, but the democratic process in India is radically different. It's a new invention of democracy. Chinese capitalism, of course, is taken from the West, but Chinese capitalism is radically very different than our Western capitalism. It's based on kinship, on basically gambling and state. The things that Max Weber said are simply non-rational capitalism, but this is what Chinese capitalism is, a mixture of basically state capitalism, kinship relations, kinship networks, and gambling. And it works very well, and it can beat the West anytime at their own capitalist game. So the point is that there is a process of globalization goes also with glocalization. Global processes become local in different places and take a different form. And all these, what is called multiple modernities, are contributing in their own way to a kind of a global culture. Well, the book has two main contributions. One is what was a relatively complex theory of secularization that put together different things. The differentiation of secular and religious spheres, the decline of religion, the fact that religion is becoming increasingly private, and all of these three developments were viewed as part of the same process. What my contribution was analytically to say these processes, secular differentiation of institutions, states, market science from religion, and differentiation of religion from these secular institutions, on the one hand. Second, the fact that religion is becoming indeed increasingly individualized and privatized, even invisible, people would say, and the fact that religion is declining. Well, these three processes in Europe, they happen to come together. But in other places around the world, they do not come together. You may have very strong differentiation without privatization and without religious decline. So this is the first contrast. The second is, it was not only that the theory of secularization said that descriptively, modern secular societies, religion becomes privatized, but liberal theory said religion is dangerous for democracy when it enters the public sphere. There is no room for religion in the public democratic sphere. And my argument was, look around the world. You have actually religious movements contributing to process of democratization. And this was the importance of the so-called third wave of democratization in Catholic societies after Vatican II. The fact that the Catholic Church, Catholic movements, that had always been a kind of resistance to democratization, play a crucial role in democratization in Poland, in Brazil, in the Philippines, even where Catholics were minorities, in South Korea, in Taiwan, in South Africa, they play a very important role. In the United States, and also even the birth of evangelical Protestantism, so-called fundamentalism in the United States, was not so much a threat to democracy, but a way of enlivening public debate in democracy. So the argument is, it is not true that empirically religions are becoming increasingly private. Look, 1979, the same year globally you have the election of the Polish Pope and the first trip to Poland that gave rise to solidarity, and of course eventually to the fall of the Soviet Union. The Islamic Revolution in Iran, the coming back of the fundamentalist, so-called Christian right, into electoral politics in the United States, and the Nicaraguan Revolution in Latin America. So you have religion entering the public sphere and contributing to actually revolutionary events in the three worlds of development: socialist, the third world, the first capitalist world. So, and then thereafter, religion has continued becoming an increasingly public important phenomenon around the world, even in Europe, where we don't see really any religious revival. Because of the coming of immigrants, religion has also become a very contested public issue. So in this respect, everywhere, religions enter the public sphere and challenges the assumptions of secular modernity, of a secular democratic state, and wants to open up the space also for religion in the public sphere. Obviously, the assumption was, I'm not claiming that all deprivatization is good. There are public religions which are a problem, and they some forms of religion. But the question is not whether religion should enter the public sphere, but which kind of religion is a threat. Not every religion, so some religions basically help democratization, others create problems for democracy. And so the question is not whether religion, but which kind of religion. So we need to have then analytical distinctions about which kind of religion leads to which kind of consequences. So this, as opposed to the secular notion that all religions lead to conflict. Partly in Europe, it's very interesting if I look at the public opinion polls. In every European country, a majority of the population, a majority believes or claims that religion is intolerant and that religion creates conflict. Now, nobody takes himself or assumes that he or she is intolerant. So if we say that religion is intolerant, it means that either we are not religious anymore and that's why we are not intolerant, or it is the religion of the others which is intolerant. Europeans, when they see religious conflicts around the world, they remember the religious wars of early modern Europe rather than the religious conflicts of the 20th century. They don't remember the World War I, the Holocaust, all the genocides, the Gulag, the Armenian genocide. All of them had nothing to do with religion. It was secular ideologies. But now Europeans think, religion is the problem. And if we get rid of religion, if we free the public from religion, there will be no conflict. But actually, this is a false premise. And of course, democratically, you cannot tell religious citizens that they have no right to enter the public sphere. So there has been a reassessment. Even such an important figure as Jürgen Habermas, the great German philosopher who was one of the great theorists of the public sphere, of democracy, of secular modernity. Now he talks of post-secular societies and of religion in the public sphere. So in this respect, he himself has adapted my position. My own position was very much developed in conversation with him, but he was not ready yet to enter into this debate. But in the last 10 years, he has realized that he needed to change his position. Well, again, whoever has what I call a secularist worldview, that believes that religion is a very primitive, traditional thing that disappears with modernity, and that the more modern, the more secular you are, then obviously if you believe this, you believe, and you see people who are religious, then you look down upon them as they are not yet modern. And so this creates a particular relationship of European secular people who view we are the only modern people when the rest of the world are religious. So this first creates a kind of problem for European identity. And this is also why religion has entered the public sphere, because as the whole world becomes more religious, the position of Europe that the whole world is going to become secular like us simply doesn't make sense. So it is people who still believe what I call the stadial consciousness, that religion belongs to a primitive stage of development and that modernity is a higher stage that gets rid of religion. If one believes in this, of course, it's not going to accept the notion. You have, of course, very aggressive atheist secularists that blame religion for everything. I remember when I was in Berlin for a year at the Wissenschaftskolleg, and the famous opera Idomeneo, and there was this famous regisseur and opera producer who was going to actually decapitate during the opera all the founders of religion, Moses, Jesus, Mohammed, Buddha, symbolically, because the thesis was violence enter history through religion. If we get rid of religion, we get rid of violence. This was the idea, the fundamental idea. But of course, this is such a stupid, historically, anybody who knows the history of these religions, those were religions that emerged precisely as critiques of sacred violence, as pacifist movements against sacred violence, that later they became once again linked to states and powers. This is a different story. But simply to reduce religion to this primitive thing that was linked to ignorance, and so the more enlightenment, the less religions, the more democracy, the less religion. This was the thesis of the enlightenment. Tocqueville already saw that in the United States this was not the case, and today we have to see that in the rest of the world this is not the case. So it forces us to rethink our relationship to the enlightenment and to European modernity. Well, in Europe at first there was no reaction, because even German sociologists, who basically, I was educated in German theology and German sociology, so my form of argumentation, my theory, is very much linked to all German debates. But there, the thesis of privatization of religion was so much taken for granted that only a few people were open to the thesis. It's only September 11 that forced everybody to take seriously religion. And then after September 11, suddenly everybody read the book, and for 10 years nobody had paid attention to the book was in 94. And the decade of the 90s, there was not much reaction in Europe. And only in the last 10, 15 years, everybody began to talk of religion in the public sphere in Europe. So this is a later reaction, not to my book, but because when they needed to think about religion in the public sphere, they found my book as a helpful way of looking into the question. Violence, especially collective violence, has always been linked to the sacred. And the sacred always sacralizes forms of violence. The question is that the religions which emerged out of the Axial Age, those are counter-religions that precisely present themselves as a critique of the religion that exists before of sacrifice. They all reject sacrifice. Sacrifice, animal sacrifice, and even human sacrifice was the core of pre-axial religions. And the fact that Christians didn't want to sacrifice to the emperor. They were called atheists. So, and because they were also pacifists. So these are religious people that challenge sacred politics, sacred violence, in the name of a new form of sacredness. And so in the 20th century, when it is the nation state that sacralizes violence, you have millions of young people being sacrificed at the altar of the nation state in World War I. And nobody even questions it. And the Pope tells Europeans, you are crazy. You are killing each other. You are turning Europe into a cemetery. What for? Today we look back and say, but these people, how could they spend 3 years killing each other barbarously to defending the borders of their sacred nation? So sacred nation, sacred citizenship was the way in which modern violence was sacralized by the state. And then you have ideologies that sacralize violence. Nazism, fascism, communism, they sacralize violence. So religion, if religion sacralizes violence, then of course it's a problem. But if religion is used to desacralize, to put into question any form of violence, so in this respect, religions can be both the problem if they sacralize violence, but the solution if they present desacralized violence, that they are critiques of every form of violence. And today we see, I mean, even now when the whole war on Syria, the Pope, never again war, the notion that there should be no war, it is religious people that have challenged the right to kill. Even today we see the fact that the abolition of the death penalty, many of the sacralization of human rights, the fact that human rights have become sacred, first with the abolition of slavery, and then after World War II, as a rejection of the Holocaust, was of course linked to the process of a modern secular enlightenment, but also religious people. It was evangelicals that were at the forefront of the abolition movements against slavery. And today, in the sacred, the defense of the sacred human rights, you have a lot of religious people also. You have people who, from the religious point of view, challenge human rights discourse. So it is both a problem and a solution. Eventually, it will be through this kind of interreligious dialogue that many of these fundamental problems of living together as different cultures in the same globe will have to be solved. Well, Gandhi and Martin Luther King. Those are precisely those who non-violent civil disobedience. Those are who present fundamental rights of people, but non-violence. The defense of any kind of rights without violence. This is the core, this is the idea of non-violent resistance. Gandhi and Martin Luther King, but also many religious people. I mean, even in the Nazi period, religious people that basically offer non-violent civil disobedience. So the notion of non-violent civil disobedience, which is the core of a democratic principle today, precisely we all have the right to non-violent civil disobedience when we do not agree with the laws of our country. So there is no... Yes.
But politicians...
Well, politicians, I mean, you see Obama wants to talk of the sacred right of the nations because the security of the nation. He is the sacred priest of the sacred American nation, right? And his primary obligation is to defend the interests of the United States. And so he gets, on the one hand, he gets the Nobel Prize for Peace, right? Because of his discourse as a democratic leader, the challenge, the Iraqi war, right? It was because he challenged the war of Bush. The Europeans were infatuated with him and gave him the Nobel Peace Prize. But now as president, he has to be the high priest of the war machine, which is the imperial power of the United States. Well, they should be even open to their own histories in a more open way. Look, the European Union came together as the result of two pacifications. On the one hand, Germany and France, who had been at war for 70 years, right? And it was this pacification. And the other was Christian democracy that brought together Protestants and Catholics who had been at war for 300 years. So the Christian Democratic parties in Benelux, in Italy, in Germany, and in France, were the ones that led to the Treaty of Rome. So the project of a European Union was a Christian democratic project, which was based on the reconciliation of Protestants and Catholics in Christian democratic parties and the reconciliation of France and Germany. Now, we have forgotten this story, but it's very important. It's very important because it was this transnational, Catholic, Christian, democratic idea which made possible for politics, even in France, where there was no serious Christian Democratic Party. In every other country, the Christian Democratic Party were ruling governments. But in France, those who were the pro-Europeanish, Schuman, and those were the Christian Democrats. The French leaders of the European Union were not Gaullist, not socialist, but Christian Democrats. A very small group in France, but they were really the leaders of the European Union. So in this respect, even remembering our own story, we can realize that if we call, instead of calling the so-called religious wars of early modernity, the wars of a state formation, then you change the story, because it's the fact is that France sided with the Protestants against Spain and the Pope. France sided with Ottoman Turkey against Spain and the Pope. You had Catholics fighting as mercenaries with Protestant armies. The notion of that the real cleavage was religious is problematic. It was really the attempt to homogenize religiously the population, so that to create a homogeneous Protestant European Northern Europe, a homogeneous Catholic Southern Europe, and then the three biconfessional societies in between, Holland, Germany, and Switzerland, that could not eliminate the minorities and had to live with biconfessional societies. But this division, this structure of European societies as homogeneous religious societies has remained until the very present, the 19th century. And only the coming of new immigrants has challenged our conception of our secular states to recognize that we still have very much Christian states that privilege Christianity over other religions despite our being very secular. It is what already Thomas Luckmann, the famous German sociologist who actually taught at the New School, and I basically was very much follow him and Peter Berger, the great theorist of secularization, called invisible religion. The religions of individual search. Individuals, each individual, even people who continued in their affiliation to churches themselves have these individual searches and look for their. There are a lot of new age people also within the churches, not only outside the churches, especially in the United States. So yes, indeed, in Europe, until now, the only option was either being within the churches or being secular, not religious. That is the famous saying of the French sociologist, Lebrun, who said, the moment a Norman peasant sets foot in Gare de Montparnasse in Paris, he ceases being Catholic. If you cease being Catholic, there is no alternative to Catholicism in France. You become simply laic, secular. You had pillars in Holland. You had the Catholic pillar, the Protestant pillar, the secular pillar. Then the three pillars collapse. And suddenly, Holland, that was a relatively religious society up to the 60s, in one single generation became the most secular society of Europe. Flanders, Flemish Belgium, again, was the most Catholic region of all of Europe. In one single generation, left the church. Quebec was the other fully Catholic society. In one single generation, the entire society left the church. But it doesn't mean that people are not religious. So my colleagues, one is Grace Davey in the United Kingdom, that has coined the term believing without belonging. You have a lot of believers in Europe that are still believers but do not belong to any church. So believers without belonging. But you also have belonging without believing in the Scandinavian societies. For instance, in Denmark. In Denmark, only 2% of the population go to church, but 80% still are members of the Church of Denmark. Because to be Danish, to be Lutheran, and to be secular are one and the same thing. And so there you can be a secular Danish Lutheran that does not believe but belong to the Church of Denmark. So believing without belonging, belonging without believing, and then religious spirituality. I'm a spiritual not religious. The fastest religion is a spiritual not religious. People that basically reject institutional religion and find their own individual spirituality. this really, the book is a collection of three essays. One of them is the anxieties, or the problem of religion and the anxieties of European democracies. Namely, I was at Israel, and they organized a conference presenting the problem of religion and how religion presents a problem to democracy. And I realized that it is our theories of secular modernity, that religion should not enter the public sphere, that has created the problem. So the idea was, this anxiety is simply a misperception of some real problems that our society, let's look at Holland. As you know, Holland had three pillars. Then it was very easy at first to think, well, the way to integrate the Muslim immigrants is to create a fourth Muslim pillar. But of course, the fourth Muslim pillar would work if you still had three pillars. But when the other pillars disappear, you cannot have a single Muslim pillar. And then Holland is interesting because while in other European countries, it was from the xenophobic right that the anti-immigrant, anti-Muslim discourse was developed. In Holland, it was pin for twin. And the argument for gay rights and toleration and liberalism that presented Islam as the intolerant, illiberal, fundamentalist religion. So it's true to a certain extent. And it reminded me of the discourse on Catholicism in the 19th century. In the 19th century in the United States, the whole discourse was Catholicism is a fundamentalist, anti-modern, anti-democratic religion that is irreconcilable with republicanism. There is a fundamental conflict between republicanism and Romanism because the Irish immigrants have these strange customs, these traditional customs. They cannot become good citizens of the United States because they are loyal to Rome, to this Ayatollah in Rome. They are papists. So whether even nobody asked them whether you are religious or not, whether you are Catholic. They represented popes and popery. So we ourselves project on Muslim immigrants. They represent Islam, but precisely the kind of vision of Islam we have created ourselves. There's a process, of course, of mutual recognition, or mutual accommodation. You cannot have immigrant accommodation. They accommodate more than we do, but we also have to accommodate. We also have to change. Our society will change in the same way that the coming of Catholics to the United States changed Protestant America. So the question is to understand these processes from a more comparative historical perspective and not to be totally caught up in our own self-understandings of the present. So this book deals precisely with the kind of the assumptions we have about religion, secular, public sphere, that there's not a lot to recognize the role of religion in the public sphere, the legitimate role of religion in the public sphere. Second, the whole discourse of Islam, anti kind of Islamic obsession. When we talk of religion today, Islam is the elephant in the room. We really think about Islam as the problem. And so, for me, the fact that Catholicism, the discourse on Catholicism 100 years ago was very similar to the discourse on Islam today. And the argument is, if Catholicism could change and it could become democratic, that certainly Islam, that has always been much more pluralistic, can also become Christian democratic or Muslim democratic. And we see process of Muslim democracy going on in Turkey, in Indonesia, in Senegal, very similar to the way in which Catholic parties became Christian democratic parties. And finally, simply the fact that our global present forces us to rethink our Christian Western theories of modernization and to realize that the very particular Western process of secularization is very much linked to Christianity, and that yes, the globalization of the model gets interconnected with other world religions, and the process will not be the same as the one that happened internally in Europe. I really think that, well, I always was a skeptic about the scientific claims of the social sciences, that their primary task is to develop general theories, general laws, copying the natural sciences. The social sciences have to be, by definition, hermeneutic sciences. I think if you read my article, I said that the definition of sociology, which I took from Habermas, a theory of the present with practical intention. The function of the social science is a form of self-reflection. This is a specialized self-reflection. They are the experts, social scientists. Not everybody can spend their life thinking about who we are, where we are coming from, where we are going, how is our society changing, what is the structure of our societies. So in this respect, we spend our professional life dedicated to these issues, but not because then we can tell what the laws of history are and we can lead historical process, but only a form of self-reflection. So the task of us social scientists is to enter the public sphere and precisely make everybody self-reflexive about our social context, our changing social situation. So when sociology emerged in the 19th century, it was in the context of the nation state. Methodological nationalism was the core of all the social sciences, economics, political science, sociology. But today in our global world, we have to open up our paradigms. We have to go beyond methodological nationalism and try to become experts of the globe. You cannot have, there are no experts on globalization. We have to become generalists again. So I'm becoming a generalist at the price, of course, of losing expertise. So I cannot claim expertise, but somebody has to do it. Somebody has to do it with some discipline, with some, if you wish, methodological seriousness. And I see that we have to become generalists again before we can develop sort of paradigms. And it cannot only come from Western social science. It will have to come from Chinese social science, from Indian social science, as they reflect upon their own societies and they look at the globe from their own perspective. All this perspective will have to converge a new type of global social science from which our own self-understanding and our mode of proceeding, of making decisions for the future, will have to come.